Hey everyone in the YouTube world, my name is Craig from Flying Wheels. Welcome to my Flying Wheels YouTube channel. I own a car dealership, and today I'm going to show you what it's like being a car dealer, negotiating deals, and all the headaches of subprime financing. Well, what is subprime financing? Low credit buyers. When I have to finance a low credit buyer, it's extremely high risk. I can't go to my typical banks. I can't go to my typical credit unions. I have to go to a subprime bank, and we're hit hard for it, and I'm going to show you what that actually means. So today's example is going to be this Audi S5. So it's a 2009 Audi S5, 80,000 miles. I hand-picked this car. I love this car. It's so much fun to drive. I bought it. I took it straight to the Audi dealer from when I purchased it. Had both catalytic converters done under warranty. That's like a $2,500 job that I had taken care of for the customer. That way they don't have to worry about it. So all warranty work, all recall work was taken care of. Then I have a friend that works on Audis and Volkswagens. I had the intake, manifold, gaskets done. Then I had it state inspected. Then I did all new brake pads and rotors. Then I did all new tires. So I want to make sure people are getting into good cars. I want to make sure they're safe. I want to make sure they're getting into something reliable. And most of all, I want to make sure they're happy with us after the sale. I want a good review. I want a repeat customer. I want people coming back and telling people to come to Flying Wheels. So I want to make sure I'm selling good cars. Now again, this Audi S5, I'm gonna use as an example for subprime financing. You'll see right in here, our asking price is $14,995, which is actually a great deal. So if somebody came in with cash, I would probably negotiate it down a little bit. I would sell it for a little bit less. If somebody came in with good credit, we could go to our credit union and finance them on no fees and low terms. Everything's gravy, everything's good. If you have bad credit, if you have subprime financing, if you need subprime financing, it's a lot more work for me, and I'm gonna show you why. So first of all, I understand. Some people get into hard positions in life. Some people struggle. Some people have health concerns or divorce. Some people are just not responsible with their money and can't handle their finances. All of those are reasons for low credit. Your credit's impacted every time you do something derogatory. Anytime you don't pay a bill, if your car was repossessed, if your house is foreclosed on, if you go into bankruptcy, all those things are going to affect your credit. And the lower your credit score, the more you are taken advantage of. Not by me, but by the banks. You're considered high risk for a reason. You weren't paying something. In a lot of cases, if your car was repossessed, why would a bank give you another car? I get calls regularly from buyers that want to buy a car. Last week, I had a customer in here that wanted to buy a car and actually had me spend my day filling out an application for them, asking questions to find out their car was repossessed last night. Their car was repossessed last night. And they're in my office trying to finance a new loan on a new car. Now, it's all about deeper questioning. I have to qualify these buyers before I even go on a test drive. So you ask the appropriate questions. Do you know your credit score? Are you currently employed? Do you have any derogatory payments? Do you have anything on your credit that would affect you from getting a loan? Do you have an existing loan on a car right now? All those are questions that you need to ask the customer before even spending your time doing the application. And before doing the application, especially going on a test drive. Why do you just want to spend your day going on test drive after test drive when these people aren't even going to be qualified enough to buy a car? Most people with good credit know what their credit score is. They monitor their credit. They monitor their finances. They're responsible with their finances. Subprime buyers tend to not be as responsible, which gets them in that position. Now, I'm not speaking for everybody. I'm speaking in generalities. Some good people get into bad situations, and I understand that. Other people just aren't responsible. Well, I get lied to every single day, especially by subprime financing. When I ask them, do you know your credit score? No, I don't. Do you have any repossessions? No, I don't. Do you have any bankruptcies, foreclosures? No, I don't. Are you employed? Yes. I have had people, now obviously to confirm employment, to verify employment, I need pay stubs. I've had people literally make fake pay stubs and bring them in for me to then call the employer and find out they have no idea who this person actually is or they were fired months ago. This happens all the time. So most people don't like used car dealers because they consider us to be liars or cheats or scam artists. It's not the case. In most cases, we're the ones getting lied to almost all the time. Okay, let's say we get through all the deeper questioning and we get to the loan process. Well, I have to take my time to fill out an application for every single customer. I pay for the platform on the computer to run credit and to run applications. All these things cost me money, plus then my time to do the application. So I'm going to show you the perfect example of what my everyday is like. The Audi S5, I asked the customer, do you have any current car loans? They said no, obviously. Well, they do. We find that stuff out. So let's go to the Audi. Now, I'm not going to say any names. I'm not going to say any credit scores or anything. I'm just going to go by the numbers. I got this customer approved on the Audi. Now, I was asking $15,000. We negotiated it down to $14,000. Well, the bank will only approve me for $11,627. So it has nothing to do with me or my price. When people say, what's your best price? If you're financing subprime, it really doesn't matter what my best price is. It's what the bank is willing to lend out. And because of a subprime deal, because of a low credit score, they might see them as high risk and only offer me a certain amount of money. So on this S5, a lot of times I'm deciding whether or not I actually want to sell a car to this customer. They will only allow me to sell my $15,000 car for $11,627 with a down payment of $2,000. Now, there's things called a discount, which is a dealer fee charged by the bank. I cannot pass it on to the consumer. I have to eat the dealer fee or the discount. So when we look right here, there's a thing called net check. A net check is the amount I'm going to get from the finance company. So I'm going to get a check for $9,227.29 on top of the $2,000 down payment. So this car, I am only going to get $11,227.29 on a $15,000 car. That's what the bank will allow. Now, we talked about discounts, we talked about fees. Check this out right here. Total lender fee, $534.99. The bank charges me $535 to finance that customer. And that's actually a low fee. Typically it's 15% plus $120 or plus $150 depending on the bank we're going to. So we're talking about a 15% discount that's charged to me as a fee. I never get to see that money. So on my $15,000 car, I end up selling it for $11,227, which is $3,900 and change less than my asking price. Now let's talk about recourse. Recourse means the bank can take the money back out of my account. They can withdraw it right out of my account if the customer does not pay that first month's bill. So if they don't make that payment on the first month, I get penalized once again. So the customer's already lied to me twice. They already have a car loan and they have subprime financing, which they forgot to mention. So I do the deal, I get it all financed. Now based on this, I'm not gonna sell this car. This buyer has not qualified through us for me to sell them a car. But let's just say the deal works, okay? We make it happen. Today is May 16th. They won't have to pay their first payment till July 1st. So they have well over 30 days to make that first payment. If they don't make the first payment, there's recourse. The bank calls me and says, Craig from Flying Wheels, your customer didn't make their first payment. I'm sorry, but we're taking that $9,227 back. We're withdrawing it out of your account on Monday. Bummer for me, right? So now what? The customer's out driving around in a car and I haven't gotten paid for it. Well, now it's up to me to go find the car and repossess it. So I can't finance a customer if they live too far away from me because it's up to me to go find that car and repossess it if they don't make their first payment. Now let's just say I do find it and I do repossess it. Well, they've been out for 30 days before their first payment, 45 days before their first payment, and then how long is it gonna take me to find the car? So let's say they're 30 to 45 days after they purchase the car before their first payment's due. Then they don't pay it. Well, it takes 2 weeks for the bank to realize they didn't pay it, call me. Now we're into it for 2 months. The customer's been driving my car for 2 months. And now I have to go find the car and repossess it on my own. It's up to me to go get it repossessed. And the bank has already taken my $9,227 out of my account back. That's how much work it is for us to sell a car to a subprime buyer. They're high risk. A lot of times we get lied to right off the bat through the entire transaction. A lot of times they forge W-2s and they forge pay stubs. It's really, really difficult to finance subprime buyers. It's high risk. There are lots of anti-discriminatory practices that we have to follow, a lot of rules, a lot of laws, and a lot of guidelines to make sure everyone is treated fairly, even when we as a dealer are not. So who's really the bad guy in this situation? I'm trying to sell a car for $15,000, I end up getting $11,200, and if this person doesn't pay for it in the first 60 days, I have to go get it repossessed and the bank takes their money back from me.
So perfect example on this Audi, because I just got a text from that customer. Oh, wait, my car is already paid off, but they did put it as an auto loan because they gave me the money that my car is worth. I forgot about that. Is that going to make my chances of getting financing harder? What? So they paid off a car, but then they got a new car loan that they forgot about. So she's been making monthly payments that she forgot about. So that's how every single deal works for me. I mean, I would say like 98 out of 100 subprime deals are typically lying to me about something, and my job is to dig through all the BS to find out the truth and then still help get them financed. Okay, so the approval's good. We're gonna get the car going. We're gonna get the car sold. Now we have to do all the paperwork. The closing documents are like home loans. It's like signing off on a mortgage. This right here is how thick the closing paperwork is for me to fill out and then read it to the customer and have them sign and initial everything. Because if I miss a single signature or an initial, guess what? I don't get funded. Now the paperwork's done. There's more. Customer has to take possession of the vehicle. Then they get a phone verification. I don't know when. Today, tomorrow, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, today, Saturday, the end of the day. They're not going to call today. They're not going to call on Sunday because they're closed. So chances are I hope they get a call Monday for the phone verification, so they get the final approval, asking questions. How much did you pay? How much did you put down? Do you understand your rate? Do you understand you need to make your first payment? If the customer answers any of those questions incorrectly, guess what? I don't get funded, which means they've been driving Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and I haven't been paid yet, except for the down payment. Now, the positive thing is if any of this stuff goes wrong, I keep the down payment. If somebody lies to me, if somebody doesn't make their first month's payment, I'm keeping that down payment for all of my time, all my trouble, and I'm gonna have to recon that car again. I'm gonna have to clean it, inspect it, and fix anything they've broken in the 2 months of driving. Okay, it gets worse. I'm in the state of New Hampshire. A customer in Massachusetts buys the car. Well, guess what? The customer has to register the car and show proof of lien in the bank's name and then bring it back to me. So what does that mean? I have to give the customer the car title and the bill of sale and let them go register it, put the title in their name, put the bank as the lien holder, and then provide proof that it has been done to the bank before I get funded. So once again, Saturday I close a deal, the registry is not open on Sunday or Saturday, and hopefully Monday. So as long as they get everything done on Monday, why are they in a big rush? They already have their car. So now there's no impulse for them to get their car registered except for me constantly calling them, hey, did you get your car registered? Did you get your car registered? Can you show me proof of registration? And then I have to submit it to the bank so then I can get funded the next day, hopefully. Okay, that's just with two of my subprime banks. There are other types of subprime financing as well. Let's talk about reserves. So you buy a car from me, I get $11,227. Wrong. No, I don't. Some subprime banks have reserves, which mean they keep a certain percentage until the car is paid off. Once the car is paid off, then they give you the balance. So let's say they hold $1,500 or $2,000 on a car, and then once the car is paid off, 24 months, 36 months from now, I will then get a check for the balance. Thousands of dollars for the balance at the very end. And then I have to hope you keep making your payments for 24 months, 30 months, 36 months before I actually get any money back. Well, let's talk about discriminatory practices. So I can't discriminate, obviously. I can't choose race, color, ethnicity, gender. Obviously, I can't give a loan or deny a loan based on those. Clearly, that's obvious. But remember that fee I talked to you about? I can't add that to the price of the car. So let's say you saw the car for a $14,000 price. Well, there's $500 in fees. I can't sell that car for $14,500 to you. It's considered discriminatory practices. So that $500, I have to eat it. I cannot roll it into the price of the car. I can't increase price based on credit. The bank will gladly charge me that fee, but I can't charge you the fee. So I'm being punished for your credit score, for your subprime financing. I'm being punished. I'm the one that has to eat the fee, and it's considered discriminatory if I charge it on top of the selling price. Then let's talk about trackers. Some cars need trackers on them. Some cars need immobilizers or disablers. So every month when you make your payment, you get a code, you punch in a little code, beep, boop, boop, beep, and then your truck runs or your car runs. If you don't make that payment, guess what? The immobilizer shuts your car off. Well, the bank's not setting those up. Guess who is? I have to install those. So we are responsible for installing the immobilizer device on your vehicle prior to you picking it up. I could go on and on and on. It is so much work to subprime finance, but there are a lot of people that do it. There's a lot of dealers that have the patience to do it, but they have their own F&I department. They have their own finance department that just does this. That's somebody's full-time job. That's how much work it is. So every day they come in and they just do it over and over and over, getting people financed. Somebody's full-time job. That's how much work it is. So when any of you need subprime financing, understand we don't set the price. The bank sets the price. Understand that we don't give you the rate. The bank gives you the rate. Understand that it costs us money. We are being punished for your credit score, for your subprime credit. I do it because, you know what? It facilitates a sale sometimes. It pushes a sale. There are people, there are dealers that just do this regularly all the time. This is all they do. This is all they focus on. Well, they have to do it in volume. If you're selling lots and lots of cars at a low price on volume, you'll make your money there, but that's a lot of work. Just know you're not gonna make a ton of money on every deal. You have to make your money over time, not every time. Hey, if this video was at all helpful, do me a favor and subscribe down below. You can hit the yellow bell and get notifications every time I make a new video. Guys, I appreciate you always watching. Thanks for the support. I'll see you later and adios.